Hi friends, this is Arvind here. Welcome to my networking channel. Hope all are doing good. And today the topic I'm going to discuss about how to configure BGP AS Override. So this is an MPLS architecture. So where I'm going to configure BGP AS Override. What is AS Override? So this is an architecture where I connected CE1 and CE2. So CE1 and CE2 are the customer edge router placed at the customer premises. And PE1, PE2 and P are these collectively called the MPLS backbone routers. So this is at the MPLS end. So whenever the CE1 receives a prefix and if it sees its own autonomous system, so this both we have configured in the same autonomous system number. So when it receives a prefix, say 5.5.5 from its own autonomous system number AS1, it will simply discard the update. So for that reason, I am going to configure this BGP AS override. So what happened? Because of that reason, this route will not be advertised over here, and same with CE2. So when CE2 receives an update from this neighbor autonomous system, so this is in the same autonomous system. So what happened? It will discard the update from this prefix. So this prefix 1.1.1 will not advertise in this corresponding BGP routing table, and 5.5.5 will not get advertised in this CE1 routing table because of the BGP loop prevention mechanism. So as per the BGP AS path loop prevention mechanism, whenever a BGP receives an update and if it sees its own autonomous system number in the path received, automatically it will discard the update. So to prevent that, we have to configure the BGP AS override on the PEN routers. So there are two ways we can configure. Either we can configure BGP allow ASN in this CE router or AS override. So there's another concept called BGP allow AS in. So that we can configure on the customer end, but this AS override we have to always configure on the provider end router. So this is an MPLS architecture. So before that, let us quickly give an overview of MPLS, how MPLS work exactly. So first, the packet will be routed from the CE1 to PE1, that is a provider end router. And in this corresponding provider edge router, this also we call it as a label edge router, where the label is imposed or the label is pushed onto the prefix or the packet. Then the label packet will be sent to this provider router. So the provider router is a core router which sits in between this PE1 and PE2. So what happens? This will swap the label. Say this label is 17, it will swap from 17 to 16, and again it will send the label packet to PE2. So at this PE2 end, this is another provider end. What happens? It will strip or remove the label, what we call it as a label pop mechanism. It will remove the label and it will send only the packet to the CE2. So that's the reason we call this as an unlabeled packet. And also keep it in mind, both the CE1 and CE2 does not have any knowledge of MPLS. So because this is a MPLS architecture and this is a non-MPLS environment, because these both are the customer end, so this is totally the provider end router. So that is the reason these three routers we collectively called as a MPLS backbone, right? So now let us see this label push and label swap and label pop mechanism, what we called as a LSR. LSR is nothing but a label switch router, which is responsible for adding the label, swapping the label or removing the label. So this also we call it as a ingress LSR. Ingress LSR nothing but at the transmitting end, we'll be adding the label. This is an egress LSR or egress LER. So at the receiving end, it will just remove the label and it will send the packet. So these are the key points you have to understand. So now let us go ahead and configure the basic configuration. So these are the basic things we'll always do in MPLS architecture. So first thing, we'll enable the VRF. So what is a VRF? VRF is a virtual routing and forwarding. So it is just like a VLAN. So VLAN will be logically segmenting a single switch into a multiple smaller broadcast domain. So VRF is assume a single global routing table. We are just segregating into each and every virtual instance or a virtual routing table. So while we are creating multiple virtual routing table, in case assume there are several customers will be there in MPLS environment, right? So there are several and millions of customers. So if you want to differentiate between several customers, then we have to assign this virtual routing and forwarding. So this will be assigning for individual customer to differentiate from the other customer, because we don't know both the customers may be using the same prefix value. So assume there are three customers, all the three customers are using the same prefix, all three are different customers. And they are using the prefix 192.168.1.0. So in that case, it can lead to overlapping the prefix. So in the MPLS environment, by assigning this VRF, we can prevent also the overlapping of prefixes, even though all are in the same prefix value. So it will prevent the overlapping. So that is the biggest advantage of MPLS. So first you'll assign the VRF. Under that VRF, I'll be assigning RD. So what is RD? Is a root distinguisher. which is used to distinguish between different customer identical routes. So the same thing already told, if there are two customers, both are using the same identical prefix. So to prevent overlapping, it is mandatory to distinguish between the several customer routes. So for that reason, we are using RD. So RD is a 64-bit value, right? RD, and RT and RD both are using the same format, but the purpose is different. RD is used to distinguish between the customer identical routes, and RT is used for importing and exporting the customer routes between the MPLS backbone. So for that reason, we are using RT, that is a route target, but both are using the same format. So this is the first configuration I'm going to do. Second thing, I'm going to configure LDP and IGP. So this LDP and IGP, I'm going to configure on this MPLS backbone, PE1 provider core router and the PE2 router. So IGP is what I'm going to configure is OSPF routing protocol. So this OSPF routing protocol will trigger this LDP between the MPLS routers. So LDP is a label distribution protocol used for advertising or distributing the labels between the routers. So that is the purpose of LDP, and IGP you have to collectively configure. So after this, I'll be configuring the MPBGP between the PE1 and PE2 routers. So MPBGP is nothing but a VPN V4 route, advertising the VPN V4 route between the provider router. We are using MPBGP. So what is a VPN V4 routers? So whenever I'm sending the route, right, label packet, we'll be also sending the RD with the prefix. So that combination of RD and prefix collectively called as a VPN V4 route, and MPBGP is a protocol we are using for advertising this VPN V4, right? So that's the thing. So that is the third thing I'm going to do. And the fourth one, what I'm going to do, I'm going to configure this both CE1 and CE2 in the same autonomous system number, AS1 and AS1. And PE1 and CE1, I'm going to configure the BGP. So IPv4 BGP, I'm going to configure. So this is an MPBGP, and this end, I'm going to configure the IPv4 BGP. So now let us do the configuration one by one. So let us go to the PE1. So go to PE1 and let us configure the VRF. So IP VRF, let us make it as red. And now let us assign the RD. RD, let us make it as 1:1. And route target, let us make it as both. Both is for both importing and exporting, 1:1. Same format we can give. Similar way, the same RD I'm going to configure on other end provider edge router. So go to PE2. Go to the configuration mode. IP VRF red, RD is 1:1, and route target both 1:1. Okay, so I'm done with this configuration. Second thing, I'm going to assign this VRF to this interface. So this interface facing the provider edge router, I always have to assign the VRF. So that's separate command called IP VRF forwarding. So go to this configuration mode, interface faster than 0/0 IP VRF forwarding, the name is red, for that is a VRF name. So then we have to assign the interface. So let us go here. Okay, so I have seen IP VRF forwarding red in this corresponding interface. So similar, we have to configure on PE2 also. So go to PE2, go to the configuration mode, interface fast Ethernet 0/0 IP VRF forwarding, you have to make red. So automatically this interface will be removed. So you have to again assign it. IP address 192.168.45.1 255.255.255.0. Let us now activate the interface. So similarly, let us go to PE1. Show run interface faster than 0/0. So this interface IP VRF forwarding red. Then this is the corresponding interface. You can check the VRF, show IP VRF. So VRF name is red, and the corresponding RD value and the corresponding interfaces. Similar, let us check in PE2. Show run interface faster than 0/0 and show IP VRF. So this will show the VRF name and the corresponding RD prefix value. So now what I am going to do, I am going to enable this LDP and IGP configuration. So IGP, I'm going to configure the OSPF. In the under OSPF configuration, I'm going to use this LDP protocol. So that will automatically trigger the LDP, and it will establish the neighbor relationship, LDP neighbor relationship with this all these MPLS backbone routers. So let us go to PE1 first. So go to the configuration mode, router OSPF 100. Network is, what is the network I'm going to advertise, is 23.0 and the loopback address 2.2.2. So network 192.168.23.0.0.0.0.255, area 0, followed by the network, that loopback address 2.2.2, 0.0.0.0, and followed by the area 0. That's a backbone area. Let us advertise the MPLS LDP. So this is the way we have to configure under the router OSPF. So both IGP and LDP I'm just configuring together. Okay, so I have done this. Second thing, let us configure PE2. Sorry, provider router. That's a core router. Go to the configuration mode. Router OSPF 100. Network is 192.168.23.0. So this is the thing, right? 23.0. 0.0.0.255. Area 0. So similar way, in the next thing is 34. Two interface, right? So 34. Then let us advertise the loopback address 3.3.3. 0.0.0.0. Area 0. Then let us advertise the MPLS. MPLS LDP protocol auto config. So this is a command for activating the LDP. So now you are able to see LDP neighbor is up. So let us go to PE2, configuration mode, router OSPF 100. Network is 192.168. So keep it in mind, only we have to take care of only this MPLS backbone, not this end. This end router, this interface you have to, we should not configure. We have to always advertise this corresponding MPLS interface. So go to PE2. 34.0.0.0.0.255, area 0, then followed by the loopback address, that is 4.4.4, 0.0.0.0, area 0. Then let us configure the, activate the LDP protocol. So now I have done with the configuration, that is second configuration is done. So now let us check the MPLS interfaces. Show MPLS interfaces will show whether the LDP is active. LDP is active. Now let us check the MPLS LDP neighbor relationship. That is whether the LDP is already established a neighbor relationship with the peer. So it is already one peer, that is 3.3.3. That is nothing but this P router, provider core router. So this is the source address. It has already established the LDP neighbor relationship with the TCP connection. Always established using TCP. So that's the thing we are able to see here. So let us go to P router. So this will be having two neighbor, LDP neighbor, 2.2 and 4.4, we are already seeing the neighbor is up. And similar way PE2, it is already the LDP neighbor is up. So these are the second configuration I have done. So there are two things you have to understand about MPLS. There are two things. One is the control plane and the data plane. So control plane is used for exchanging the routing and the label information. So the routing information is exchanged using the protocol, that is IGP, right? That is OSPF is done for exchanging the routing information here, and LDP. So label information is exchanged using LDP. So LDP is used for distributing and advertising the labels to the neighboring routers. So for that reason, we are using LDP. So this both works at the control plane. So control plane is used for exchanging the routing and the label information. And data plane, what is a data plane? It is used for forwarding the packet. So here it will forward the packet based on the, forward the packet based on this label information, right? So here, for how we can find it out, by seeing the MPLS forwarding table. So based on the label information, because each and every prefix, it will be attached to the label. So based on the label information, we will forward the packet. So that information we call it as a MPLS forwarding table. So this works at the data plane. So based on this label information, it will forward the packet to the neighboring routers. So that is the purpose of attaching the label to this prefix. So that's the purpose of MPLS, right? And the second thing, so we have configured this VRF and LDP IGP configuration. So now the third configuration, I'm going to configure the MP BGP between the PE1 and PE2 router. So now let us configure. So now let us see how to configure MP BGP between PE1 and PE2, right? So go to the PE1 router. So I'm going to establish the MP BGP between PE1 and PE2. So that is a way of advertising the VPN V4 route between the provider edge 1 and provider edge 2 router. So how to configure, go to the configuration mode. So this PE1 and PE2 I'm configuring in 234. I'm going to configure in AS autonomous system number 234. So go to this PE1 router BGP 234 and the neighbor is IBGP neighbor, right? because this is 2.2.2 loopback, this is 3.3.3, and this is 4.4.4. So neighbor is 4.4.4 and the remote is 234. Again, we have to specify the update source loopback 0, because we are using the loopback. So I have to specify the update source loopback 0. Then I have to activate the address family. Why address family? Only through address family I can configure the MP BGP and I can advertise the VPN v4 route. So VPN v4 route between the provider edge router. Then let us do neighbor 4.4.4 activate. Similar configuration I have to do on other end router also. That is PE2 also I need to do. Go to this PE2, go to the configuration mode, router BGP 234, and the neighbor is this end loopback address is 2.2.2, right? So 2.2.2, remote AES is 234, and we have to specify the update source loopback 0. Update source is nothing but, since I'm specifying the loopback address, I have to give update source loopback 0. Then we have to activate the address family. Address family is VPN v4. Since I'm exchanging the VPN v4 routes between this P1 and PE2, I am just going to use this address family VPN v4. So VPN v4, I already told, it is a combination of RD and prefix. So while advertising this label, it will always advertise the part of prefix. It will also add the RD with the prefix and it will send it to the provider router. So that is the purpose I'm configuring address family VPN v4. And this is for configuring the MP BGP between the PE1 and PE2. So the neighbor is 2.2.2 activate, right? So you're done with the configuration. So one more thing is pending. As I discussed already, since I'm configuring only the VPN v4 route between this PE1 and PE2, so it's better to remove the IP v4. How to we can remove is, go to this configuration mode, router BGP 234, address family IP v4. We have to make it as IP v4. No neighbor, that is a PU2 neighbor, that is 4.4.4. So this is the way we can remove the IPv4. Similar way, let us go to PE2, go to the configuration mode, router BGP 234, and address family is IPv4, no neighbor, 2.2.2, that is a PE1 address, loopback address, activate. So this will remove the IPv4. I'm going to activate only this VPN v4. That is the purpose of doing this. So now let us see the configuration. So how to check the VPN v4 routers? Show BGP, VPN v4, unicast, all summary. So the neighbor is up and I'm able to ping the neighbor. Let us see. Ping 4.4.4, source loopback 0. So I'm able to reach. Similar way, let us check from PE2N. Neighbor is up, right? Show BGP, VPN, V4, unicast, all summary. So now let us ping the neighbor. 2.2.2, sources, loopback 0. So I'm able to reach the P1 and PE2. So the third step is over. VRF is done. LDP, IGP configuration is completed. MP, BGP, we are done. So the fourth step, what I'm going to do, I am going to enable the BGP, IPv4 BGP between CE1 and PE1 and CE2 and PE2. This is a PE2, right? So both the thing I am going to configure with the same autonomous system number, that is AS1, because I want to show how BGP AS override works. So let us go here, CE1, go to the configuration mode, router BGP1, and what is the neighbor? So the neighbor is 192.168.12.2, right? So 192.168.12.2 and the remote AES is 234. That's the thing we have configured. MPLS backbone AES is 234. Now let us advertise the network. So the network, what is the network, is this loopback. 1.1.1 mask is 255.255.255. So that loopback address I'm advertising as the prefix over here. Similar way, let us go to CE2. Same autonomous system number, right? So router BGP1. And the neighbor is 45.1, right? So 192.168.45.1, remote AES is 234, and the network is, I'm going to advertise a loopback as a prefix, that is 5.5.5. So network 5.5.5, mask is 255.255.255. So this is the thing I have done, and CE1 also we have done the prefix, right? Yeah, CE1 also we have done. So now let us configure the PE1. So I have to activate this neighbor also. So let us go to PE1, go to the configuration mode. So router BGP 234, we have to specify address family IPv4. Why? Mean this is an IPv4, right? Customer route. So that's the reason I'm configuring address family IPv4. We have to specify the VRF name. There may be several customers, right? So always you have to enable the VRF name. So if there are multiple customers, say CU2, CU3, it will be confusing. So always we have to use the VRF name to identify which customer route, right? So VRF red, then we have to specify the configuration. Neighbor is 192.168.12.1, this neighbor. 12.1, right? This neighbor. Then remote AS is 1. Then let us advertise the prefix. Prefix is 192.168.12.0 and the mask is 255.255.255.0. So I'm going to advertise this network also. That's the reason I advertise this as a prefix. Similarly, let us go to PE2. Configuration mode. So this is the BGP neighbor between PE2 and CE2. I'm going to configure now. So router BGP 234, the same thing we have done over here, right? 234, right? Address family IPv4, VRF red, then I have to specify the neighbor. What is the neighbor? Is 45.2. So 192.168.45.2 and the remote AS is 1, same autonomous system, and the network is 192.168.45.0, mask is 255.255.255.0. So now we are able to see the neighbor is up, right? Neighbor 192.168.45.2, VRF is up. So that means the neighbor is up. Now let us check the neighbor relationship from CE1 router. Show IP BGP all summary. So you are able to see the neighbor is up. I am able to see reach the neighbor. That is 192.168.12.2. I am able to reach. Similarly, let us check from CE2. IP BGP all summary. But this is not our purpose. So we need to reach from CE1 all the way to CE2. So that is the purpose of MPLS, right? So now let us see the first routing entries. So let us do a show IP route. So if I'm doing a show IP route, I'm not able to see this corresponding prefix. I'm only seeing this prefix. So this prefix is not advertised. Why? Means I already told, because of the loop prevention mechanism. So whenever this C customer edge router receives a prefix from this corresponding thing, it will discard the update. So how we can avoid this? How we can prevent this? So that is a command to configure on the provider edge router, that is BGP AS override. So we have to configure this BGP AS override always on the provider edge router. So we have to go ahead and configure the provider edge router. So go to the configuration mode. So see, you can see the entries over here also. CE2 also. Show IP route. You can't see the corresponding entry, that is 1.1.1. You can't able to see the prefix. So how to configure is, go to the configuration mode. So go to the provider edge router, right? So go to the provider edge router, router BGP 234, address family IPv4, VRF red. Under this thing, we have to use the command called override, that is AS override. This is the command you have to do. So neighbor 192.168. What the neighbor is 45.2, right? 2, then AS override. So automatically you should see the entries. The same thing. So you're able to see, right? Neighbor is again coming up. So the same thing I have to configure on this PE1 also. So go to PE1 router. So router BGP 234, address family IPv4, VRF red. So under this, configure neighbor 192.168.12.1 AS override. So this is the command I mean to say. So after doing this, what happened? Automatically you can see the prefix over here advertised here. So this prefix 5.5.prefix will get advertised in this routing table, BGP routing table, and this prefix will get advertised in this routing table. So that is the purpose of configuring. So without this, you can't see the prefix. Why? Both are in the same autonomous system. So this will think that whenever it receives a prefix, its own autonomous system, it will simply discard this prefix. That is 5.5.5. The CE1 will discard and CE2 will discard this prefix. So that is the purpose of configuring the AS override on PE1 and PE2 router. So now let us see the routes. So now you can see the route entries, right? You are able to see the prefix 5.5.5, and you can see it is advertising as a BGP route. Similarly, let us go to CE2. Let us do the show IP route. So you are able to see this 1.1.1 advertised, right? So now let us do the trace route. Let us do a trace to CE2 5.5.5 sources loopback 0. So now you are able to see the trace. Similar way, let us see from CE2. Trace is 1.1.1. There's a CE1 address source loopback 0. So you are able to see how the trace is going, right? So from CE1, if you are able to see the trace, 12.2, 12.2, then again 23.2, and the label you are seeing is 17. So this is a label 17, and again 45.1. So this is 45.1, and again it is reaching 45.2. So here you can't see the label because it is an unlabeled packet. It will reach as a packet. So this end also you can see here. It will reach from 45.1, then 34.1. 34.1 label is 16, right? So this label is 16. So again it will reach to 12.2. 12.2, and again it will come over here. So this is the way it will reach the trace. So only thing you have to keep it in mind is there are two labels. I already discussed that. So one is a transport label and another one is a VPN label. So only the transport label is used for transportation of this service. And the VPN label is used to define the different VPN thing. We can also call this as a service label. Only the transport label will be swapped at the core router. That is from 16, 17, it will swap to 16 and it will send it to the provider edge router, right? And the VPN label will always remain the same. So that label is 20. You can see this is also 20. From the CE1, you can see here. This all label is also. So it will, the VPN label more or less remains the same. So this is how it will work, right? So the BGP AS override, how it works is we have to configure always on the provider edge router. So allow ASN is another concept. We always configure on the customer edge router. But this VPN label I already told, right? So the VPN label, there are two types of label. One is a transport label and the VPN label. So sometimes you can see the same label, but here we are seeing the different label. So here it is assigned automatically. The label is 19. But always it will add the transport and the VPN label at the provider edge router, and at the receiving end it will just remove the label and it will only send the packet to the CE2 router. So that is the difference between transport and the VPN label. So only the transport label will be swapped, but the VPN label remains the same. So for some reason it has assigned a different label. So here it is seeing the VPN label is 19. So but this end you are able to see the VPN label is 20, right? So VPN label it can assign for a different VPN service. So that is the difference between a VPN and the transport label. So the transport label we are using for transportation of labels across the provider. But the transport label will be swapped at the provider end, right? In the provider core router will be transporting, we will be swapping the label from 17 to 16. But this VPN label always remains the same from this provider edge to PE2. But the another difference is at the PE1 router, the transport and the VPN label it will add, and at the receiving end it will strip off both the label and you can see only the packet. So you can see only this packet. There is no label at the receiving end from both CE1 and CE2, right? You are able to see, right? So this is the only difference. So I hope you enjoy this video. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos. Thank you and have a wonderful day. Thank you.